Just a quick show of hands so I understand who's in the room. How many people here come from an object-oriented background? Quick show of hands. Pretty much everyone, okay. This session is mostly about trying to understand what's the right balance between object orientation and basically taking some of the functional concepts and applying it so we can take advantage of some of these things while we are still working in a typical object-oriented language, and specifically how to use test-driven development as an approach to kind of help you, you know, implement some of these practices, implement some of these techniques in your programming. One of the common things that we hear a lot is O equals modeling the real world, like object orientation is about modeling the real world. How many people think of object orientation this way? Okay, so one takeaway hopefully by the end of this workshop is you will understand why this is actually wrong, or why this is not the case, or should not be the case. So obviously soon you end up with stuff like this. Right, suddenly a truck is inheriting from a car because it has to reuse some of the functionality that is there in the car. Or you have all kinds of other deep nested hierarchy and other kinds of problems that you end up with, which just does not make sense, you know, but you end up doing that because you originally started by trying to model your software on the real world, and at some point, you know, that fell off, but you wanted to reuse code and you ended up basically, you know, bending over your back to get stuff done. I'm sure people would have seen, you know, code bases like this where you try and pull up a hierarchy and this looks as scary as this. So for me, like the main tipping point from O and kind of understanding what really is a challenge with O was when I was working on a medical system, which basically is about automating the stuff that happens at a hospital. And one of the classic debates in our team we had is, you know, basically a patient comes in and the patient needs to get certain vaccinations, right? So, you know, the debate was, okay, you read through the requirement and then you look at, okay, all the nouns. So you pick, okay, doctor is a noun, so you have a doctor class. You have a patient is a noun, so you pick up a patient class. And you go through all of that and then you come up to, okay, what are the verbs? So we can figure out what are the methods that go on each of these things. And so the debate that happened in our team was like, you know, should the doctor have a give shot method, right? Give, you know, rabies vaccination or some vaccination shot, or should the patient have a take shot method? Where do you put this method? Right, and the debate went on because both sides had a valid argument, and suddenly there was a third side which said, well, nurses also give shots. Right, so now the case for having this method on the patient became stronger, but then the case was, can patients give a shot to themselves? And the point I'm trying to get at is that with O, we end up with a lot of these kind of debates and we try to model the real world, and then we are confused because we all have different perspectives of the real world. And so our software becomes as complicated as a real world when, in my opinion, software is about abstracting, you know, it's about abstraction and it's about trying to simplify things. So eventually the whole debate ended saying, who cares who gives a shot to whom? All we care is whether we charge the patient or not. Right? The patient could might well as give a shot to themselves. We are interested in basically charging the patient. Like, that's what should be our focus. So I think basically O gets a lot of bad name for behaviors that you see like this. But, you know, if you really think about it, is it because of O itself? Or is it because of people's interpretation of what O is? But then what is the right interpretation of O? Right? And hopefully this session is going to give you a view of what probably, in my opinion, is the right interpretation of O, and how, you know, functional concepts can very well coexist with some of these concepts, right? I mean, we will talk about mutability, we will talk about some of these core concepts and how those can be very well achieved with O languages. It's a little harder in some cases than not. But then adding test-driven development as a thing on top of it, how does that actually push you towards pure functions, towards side effect free, towards, you know, other kinds of things, method chaining, a little bit of, you know, we'll talk about maybe monad kind of a stuff. So how you kind of get into that kind of a mindset. So in a gist, this is kind of the focus of this workshop is what's the right way to think about object orientation? How can, you know, you take some of the functional concepts and apply it, and can they actually coexist with an object-oriented world? And really, to tie everything together, how does test-driven development kind of help you tie all these pieces together? So that's kind of what the focus will be. So basically, it's a 120-minute session. I did this last time at the jQuery conference, and it was about 90-minute session, and we couldn't get through a lot of concepts, so we kind of extended it to a 120-minute session. This is supposed to be a hands-on code along kind of a workshop, so you actually get you know, some of the benefits of understanding some of these concepts. So that's the idea. So we will go through some basic setup and get you up and running. If we do get time, I would like to actually show how we can stub out AJAX calls, how to, you know, deal with side effects from those kind of things and stuff like that. What we are kind of trying to build is basically this particular plugin. It's a jQuery plugin for basically comments. It's a part of what we built and as part of the Conf engine. So it's a real world example. So, you know, for commenting, how, you know, how do we build a plugin which can basically, you know, build your comments out on any page kind of a thing. Kind of pretty much like discourse if you've seen, discuss if you've seen that. So this is kind of a plugin that helps us achieve that. So this is what we will try and achieve in this workshop. It's a bit ambitious. There's a lot of moving parts in this, but we'll see how far we can get, all right? Let's quickly touch upon test-driven development as a concept before we dive in, just so we all are on the same page of what we mean by test-driven development. How many here are familiar with the concept of test-driven development? Okay, that's pretty cool. So I probably don't need the next slide, but I'll do it any which ways. All right, so what's the real concept with test-driven development? What do you know about test-driven development? A lot of experts raised their hands, so what do you guys know about test-driven development? Let's make this interactive. Write the test first and then write the code to make the test pass, okay? Write a failing test first, that's more important. So write a failing test. So when you're saying failing, I'm assuming you mean an automated failing test. It's not a Excel file somewhere, right? Focusing on what you want rather than focusing on the implementation or the how part of it, and kind of having that clear focus separation in some sense. Most often when we talk about test-driven development, people think it is a testing practice. It is a thing that we do for testing, right? That's one of the problems with the name, test-driven development, because people think it's about testing. But actually, TDD is about design. It is a design practice, not a testing practice. And so a lot of times people start focusing on all the edge cases and all of those things when, you know, the point is about, does it help me flush my design out? Right, so it's a design exercise and we'll look at that. So just quickly recapping, we add a test. It's obviously an automated test, so we can run the test. When we run the test, we expect the test to fail. What happens if the test passes? You've got to be suspicious. Something's wrong. Maybe your test is not right. So idea is the test should fail. And if the test fails, then what do we want to do? So make a little change or add some code, make a little change to your code to make it, you know, pass, right? So focus right now is to get the test to pass. The focus is not, can I architecturally build an awesome thing? Can I really have a great performant, you know, algo for this? That's not the focus at this point, right? Our focus is to make the test pass, and if it fails, continue running it till it passes. And once it passes, what do we do? Good. So now is the time to actually focus on the design. Now that you have a basic working thing, now let's look at how to make this design better. I'm not saying you write sloppy code and then try to make the code better, but in spite of putting in your due diligence and writing good code, you will always find that design is an iterative process. It's not a one-stop thing, right? So you will still find ways of improving the design. You might think of better abstractions, you might think of better things. And so you would refactor, and we refactor always when passing tests, and you go back and repeat this cycle. And that's kind of in a nutshell what TDD is. I first read about this in 2001, and I actually fell off the chair laughing, because I thought this must be a joke. Someone's like pulling off a real good one here, right? How is this even practical? How can I even write a test without knowing what my implementation or what my design looks like, right? So it just seemed impossible at that point. But the more I practiced, I think it took me about 4 years before I could say, you know, give me any problem and I can test drive it. You know, so it's about 4 years before I could actually get that real comfort of what test-driven development is all about. And it's been about maybe 2 years I don't write any tests anymore. So I've kind of moved on from test-driven development. But I still think it's a very important practice, you know, especially when you're working in large teams. My context is I work in a really small team, and you know, it's a team of really sharp developers and, you know, pretty much not stepping on each other most of the time, so we are okay to kind of do stuff on our own. But if you're in a large team, some of these things become more important, from safeguarding your code from others, changes from communication point of view, and other good practices that come along with it. Anyway, so that's a quick background about TDD, and let's kind of, I don't know, like anyone who's done test-driven development, have you asked the question, why such a fundamental change in the way we're doing development? Because this is, in my opinion, a fairly fundamental change in the way we do software development, right? I mean, we are kind of, at least I was used to doing analysis, design, then coding, and then if any time was left, testing. But I was a good developer, so I never needed testing, right? I mean, that was how I grew up as a programmer, and then this seemed like a fundamental change in what I believed how to do software development. So has anyone wondered why such a fundamental change? So what I'm hearing is basically it's about early feedback, right? It's ability to have something quick and early feedback, not just for the programmer, but also get something quick and running, get it up and running, so you can actually demonstrate it to someone and see if, you know, what someone wants is kind of what you're trying to build. So a lot of people talk about this as a tool for rapid development, which is kind of contrary to what a lot of people who look at this think about, because they say now it's going to take double the time to do software development than it used to take. So there are some very interesting non-intuitive aspects about test-driven development. But the most important thing for me about test-driven development is how it helps me design things, or how it gives me a way to design things and to learn things very quickly because of the shorter feedback cycle. If I have a doubt and I want to try out something, I write a test and I quickly try it out. Right? So it gives me the ability to try out things. And that's going to be very important as we go in, because we will say, okay, you know, this has some side effects. So can I change this so that I can get rid of the side effect? And can I experiment that very quickly, right? So it gives you a platform to experiment things very quickly and give you feedback about that. To me, that's a very important aspect that we will look at, all right? Let's kind of jump into some basic setup. How many people want to code along? Right, that's good. So fire up your machines, get into whatever your projects folder, whatever is your typical projects folder, and then git clone this repo. All the slides are already available online, so in case, you know, if you want to make notes, don't worry, it's already up there. Okay, done. Once you've got that, run an npm update. It might take a little while to run the npm update, but just fire it up and let it run in the background. The idea is to have this completely self-contained so we can work on this. And then we're going to get into basically installing the karma command line in case you want to run things from the command line. And I've just installed it at a global level so I can use it in any other place. And once we are done that, I'm going to switch now, and I'm going to show you this. All these steps I've already done. I'm going to switch now and start from the karma init step here. Okay, is this visible to everyone? All right, so let's do karma init. It says what framework you want to use for this demo. I'm going to be using Jasmine, which is a TDD/BDD framework for JavaScript. It says, do you want require JS? No. What browsers do we want to run our tests against? One of the nice features about Karma is you can run your test against multiple browsers simultaneously. So as you're developing, you can get feedback around the different browser combination. So I'm going to go with Chrome, Firefox, Safari, and PhantomJS. Right? It says what locations do you want to include? Where is your source file? So I have something in lib, which is all my external dependencies, lib.js. I have stuff in my source /*. It says it's not there, that's fine. And then finally my spec /*/*spec. .js. So this basically takes the stuff. I don't need anything to be excluded. Do you want Karma to watch files? No. And that's pretty much it. So it's generated a config file. We can quickly jump into the project here and we can see where the config file is generated. So this is not source, this is JS. So this is basically it's saying, okay, whatever, some basic config, these are all the files it will load when it runs the tests, and a bunch of other parameters, and here are all the browsers that we want to run the test against, right? Now what we can do is we can simply right-click and run these tests. It's going to spin off different browsers that we mentioned there, and right now we have a very basic spec, an empty spec. I guess the spec that I had in here, which is an empty, just a basic spec, what it does is it basically makes sure that jQuery is available to you, right? Just a very basic stuff. Everyone's with me so far? So just getting the basic stuff out of the way so we can start focusing on building the jQuery plugin itself and trying to, you know, build this more in the functional style. So this is good. Let's get this out of the way. We don't need this. So this is our spec, and this is our basic jQuery plugin, just the shell. Nothing inside this as of now. This is a pretty standard way of writing a jQuery plugin where you basically, try to scope yourself the dollar within a function, an anonymous function, and then directly just call that. And then here, you know, you can write whatever you want to write. This is our jQuery comments, is our plugin that we're going to be building. So what is the first thing we can think of from a functionality point of view that we would want to achieve? I would say the simplest thing I can think of is what happens if there are no comments to be displayed. Right? Is it possible? Yeah, there will be always a case when, you know, I have no comments on a page and I want to basically show some kind of a nice message. Right? So should show a nice message when no comments are present. So we need to call our jQuery. So I am hoping that there would be some kind of a div called comments div, and I basically want to call the jQuery comments on top of that. And once I do that, then what do I expect to see? I expect that the comments, right, to have element I'm thinking what should be the right thing to do. I want to basically want to figure out on the comments, if I have a comments, then it should contain, right? To contain element, what element do I expect this to contain? So I could say this should contain an element, some kind of empty div, right? Some kind of an empty div with a message saying that no comments are present or something like that. So I would expect this to be a dot or a div dot empty, let's say. And then I would also expect dot find the same thing, div dot empty, to contain some text. What kind of text? Be the first one to write a comment. Something like this. This is what my expectation is, that once I actually have my plugin built, if I run this, then it should contain a div with an empty inside it, and the empty div should contain some kind of a message. Okay? Now, one of the things we need to do is we need to actually have a page on which we're going to have this comments div, right? So we're going to use a quick thing over here. So I'm going to set fixtures, and I'm going to add a div with an ID comments. So this is going to add whatever this framework is going to build a in-memory page, and on that in-memory page it's going to add a div with comments, which is what we're going to operate on, right? Notice it's actually not going to, you don't need anything more fancier than this to be able to test this out. So it's pretty simple. So we've got that, we've got this. So now let's go back and run our tests and see what happens, right? Is this looking okay to you guys? What do we expect now? We expect a bunch of tests to fail. So should find jQuery is still passing. However, it says can't find a reference. Oh, okay, it can't find set fixture. So that is basically we need our karma config file. And let's add one other thing this needs. This needs Jasmine jQuery. This is another plugin for the Karma framework, which allows us to write stuff on the with jQuery specific stuff, which is where these methods, the set fixture methods, would come from. Let's run this. There we go. So now we are seeing that should have contained this element, but we don't see this element, right? That's what it's telling us. So what do we do? What's the next step? Write the code to make this test pass. So it's complaining that we basically expected the comments container selector to contain a element div.empty, right? So right now we don't have a div.empty because our jQuery plugin isn't doing anything at all, right? So we need our plugin to actually, so we need to write some code inside our plugin. Right now we're just saying return this. So what do we do? Basically, we can say something as simple as this. What class is this? Empty dot append. And what was our message? Let's copy the message. This is what we want. So this is gonna give us a empty div, right? And then we wanna say this dot append the empty div. That's it. That got our very first test to pass, right? That's basically saying whenever you call this plugin, it's always gonna give you an empty div because there's no way you can pass anything into it. So let's do something a little bit more interesting now, right? What's the next thing we want to do? So I'm going to say should display a single comment, right? So I want to display a single comment. So I'm going to first time copy some of these things and then we were going to refactor later. Once we got the test passing. So I have the comments, I've got this thing, and then there needs to be some way to pass the comments, right? So there are possibly in our plugin, there are two ways you can pass it. One is you can pass in a list of comments into the function when you call it, or you could, you know, pass a URL, and it'll basically fetch the comments from that URL. So we'll start with the easier one, which is we are giving it the comments, the data. Next, we will look at, you know, basically fetching using Ajax from a URL the comments back, all right? So what we need to do is we need to pass a comments, this thing. So let's say comments, and our comments is going to contain, it's going to contain an array, right? An array of comments. So what's the first element? So this might have something like the message itself of the comment. We're gonna say first comment. And then this probably will also have the user who put in the comment, right? So I'm just gonna put my name here, which I can't type. So we are right now passing one comment which has a message and a user, and we're passing that into our comments. And then what do we expect? We expect that this should not contain this div empty. It should actually contain a div with comment, right? We want to nest it inside a comment. And then we are saying find this comment, and this should contain an element. What element would this contain? So I'm going to say let's just do this. This is a simpler one. So I'm just going to say this should contain our comment, right? First comment by Naresh Jain, something like this. Our comment div should contain something like this. We're going to evolve this. We're going to make this a little bit better, but just take some quick baby steps to get this to work. Let's run this. Expect what to fail? If first two tests are continuing passing, the third one is failing. It says, you know, you did not want this empty div, but it is there. You wanted comments, but it is not there. Everyone with me so far? Taking really small steps, but we'll pick up pace as we get more comfortable with this. So what do we need to do in our plugin? First of all, we are taking some options here, right? And you know, the jQuery standard way of doing this is you're going to have some defaults. This is also very functional in style. I'll talk about that a little bit. But what we're going to do is we're going to take some defaults in which we're going to say comments is an empty array. In case the user didn't pass anything, just take this. And then we're going to say var options equals extend defaults, and then override it with the options. So if some options are passed in, then map it on to this defaults, override the defaults. If nothing is passed in, then just take the defaults, right? So now we have options which basically should contain the comments or nothing. So if options.comments dot length, is it length or size? Length equals, no, I don't want Picasa, equals 0, then we want to do something like this. So I'm just going to rename this to a better name. So let's call this content. And possibly, so what I want to do is notice I am intentionally not really trying to write the most elegant code right now. I'm just trying to get this to work so then I can make it much better. So I'm going to put an if else and all of that stuff, but eventually, or rather in the next 1 or 2 minutes, we're going to get rid of that. So next, what do we want to do? So if the comments this thing, then we're going to say, we want to loop over all the comments now, right? So we're going to say options.comments. For each, pass it a function, which will get an element. And inside this, we want to take each element and basically plonk it on into our top-level container div, right? So we'll need something similar to here. Right now, it's safe to assume that we only have one comment, so I'm just going to directly try and plonk into this. We said we're going to take the element dot comment, not comment, element dot message. By element dot user. Would this work? Yeah? No? Should, right? Let's run the tests. Sure enough, that worked. Obviously, it doesn't work if you pass more elements and all of that stuff, but right now our test is not forcing us to implement those kind of logic as of yet. Actually, I'm going to reduce the size a little bit so it fits a little better on the screen. Is this still visible to you guys? Okay, cool. So we got the test passing. Now, what's the next step in this cycle? Should we move on to the next test, or do we want to refactor and clean up some of the things that we have done? Right. So now is the ideal step where we want to actually clean up some of the stuff, improve the design. Right. So the very first step we can see is there is a bunch of duplication here, here and here. Right. So let's get rid of that. We're going to use something called for each. or before each. Before each, what do we want to do? We want to set these two guys up. End up making this over here, so it's accessible downstairs. So we can get rid of these two lines. Okay. What else can we get rid of? Quickly run the test. Still should be passing. Expectations could be cleaned up a little bit, right? I'll leave that for the moment, because you know we are going to revisit this in a minute. Let's come to our production code and see what can be improved here. I would be inclined to take this whole thing out into a separate thing and deal with it over there, right? So I'm going to simply extract this into a global function. I'm going to call this as commence.html. So what I just did is I pulled out all that stuff from here so that this function remains as simple as this as we go building on. Here we only want jQuery specific stuff. And then we want to decouple ourselves from any jQuery specific stuff. And we want the rest of it to be kind of clean, more specific to the domain that we are working on, right? This is actually a very important step. From here onwards, we will see how this is actually going to drive our design in a very functional style, if you will, right? So let's get this thing going. We can obviously run the test. Hope everything should still continue to pass. Now, what are the kind of things we can do? One pretty straightforward thing you could do, because you've extracted this out, is that get rid of this guy. Let's keep content here. Is this cool? There is a typo. Okay. I would say for now this is good enough. This will be forced to change again when we write the next test. So what is the next test we want to write? Actually, let me pause. Is this okay with everyone? This looks decent enough, right? For now. We need more work to be done, and which is where we need the next test, which will force us to do more work. So I should display multiple comments. So we only had one comment. Now let's see what happens if we have multiple comments. Does it work for multiple comments? We could see the output in the browser as well. Let's do that in a minute, one second. So whatever, John Doe. And hang on. Do you want to actually see the output first in the browser before we, actually I can leave this in here. Let's, one of the things while we are doing test-driven development, occasionally it's good to actually see if we are not working off completely in ether, right? So let's actually bring up the browser and see how does this look in the browser. So we have a basic stuff over here, and this guy would need, let's say we need to pass in some comment, right, into this guy, jQuery guy. What did I take extra? That should be good. Oh. So all I have is a basic just boilerplate thing here. It includes the JavaScript library, the jQuery library, the comments thing, and then we're going to call our comments guy on this. So let's see, how does this look in Chrome? Be the first one to comment. Why is it showing be the first one to comment? Oh, there we go. So I missed out that portion. So comments, right? So first comment by Naresh Jain. So does this work? We are not just fantasizing on our own. It does actually work. Actually, now that I look at this, this doesn't look all that good. Maybe we want to give it a little bit better styling before we kind of continue doing more stuff. So maybe, you know, it's actually a good time before we jump off onto the next spec to finish off this. So I'm actually going to roll back that adding a new test. And how do we want this to be styled? So let's say we want to say that this contains this div. And this particular div, I would say, let's say we want to say that this contains another div within it, inside the comments. Let's call that header, okay? And similarly, we have the body. And in the header, I would expect something like whatever by this guy, and in the body I would actually expect the actual comments, first comment. Does this make sense? We're just trying to put a little bit of structure to it before we run. Now obviously if we run the test, this should fail. Yeah, sure enough, it does fail. It fails because that structure, what we have is we're just plonking in straight right away into this, right? So let's actually build that same structure that we wanted. So first of all, we said that we're going to have some kind of a div, which is going to say add class. What was the class name? We said header. And header, we said should append by element dot user. And then we said we need a body which contains the message and no by, just directly the message. And then those two things then getting appended onto the, we'll have to store this as a header, store this guy as the body, and then here we're going to add the header and then we're going to add the body. That got the test to work. Let's make sure this guy still works. There was a little bit of styling that we want to make sure works. So let's, okay, so we have here comments header. Let's actually make that just header and body. Okay, some kind of basic styling seems to be working as well as we go along. There is a library for testing just CSS itself, if that's working correctly. Right now I'm just focusing on the JavaScript and the jQuery side of things. So we're not really testing the CSS part. Is everyone okay with me? Is everyone with me so far? Any questions, any doubts so far? Does this seem like a lot of effort? Yeah, there are libraries for testing CSS. James Shore has actually built one. If you Google for James Shore, there is a CSS TDD library that is built. Okay, shall we continue? Let's go to the next test now. I could actually get rid of these two things. It's not really required, because if those two divs are not present, automatically these guys are going to fail, saying I can't find the element. So sometimes, you know, just writing unnecessary stuff in the test is not really helpful, so we can just get rid of that. Now let's try and write the next one, which is a little bit more interesting, is should display multiple comments. So we got the first comment. Let's take the second comment. So what do we expect here? Here we specifically expect, like, one thing we expect is that when you find for this div.comment, then you expect the size to be what? You want two elements, two divs, right? So we want two divs to be present, and then we're going to say comments first should have this, and then right now it's only two, so we can simply say last. Here what do we expect? John Doe, and here we expect second comment. Make sense? Will this work? Should work, right? Now, why? Expected one to be two. It expected two elements, but it got only one. Why? If you notice here, while we are looping, we are simply overriding the previous value, which worked well for case of one, but the moment we have multiple, this is not going to work, right? So it's a good way to basically catch issues like this. So I'm going to do something interesting. So we're going to say comments dot append this whole thing, and now what will happen is it will return this element with an extra div. So we can simply do the HTML of it. Now this did not work. Why it did not work? Undefined is not a function. Oh, okay. I know what's going on. Let's get this guy to be the comment. You want to append the comment? No? What am I missing? Oh, it's not dollarized. Yep, so that's good. That's good to know. Why wouldn't this work? Because it's a string. Ha, there we go. It's all about the money. All right, this works pretty well. Time to see if there's any scope for refactoring. The tests could be improved. There's a bunch of repetitive stuff that could be removed. But I'm more interested in looking at how can we improve the design of this. What can be done over here? This is where I think we're going to go a little bit of balancing the OO and the functional aspect here. So I'm going to try and wrap this into some kind of immutable object and then kind of turn that to have pure functions inside that. All right. So what I mean by that is I'm going to simply say new commence and then pass the dollar to it. Actually, let's take this guy out. So that's our commence. And then I'm going to call a method on the commence, say .toHTML, by passing the options to it. Something of this nature. So Alt Enter, create a function, the global scope. Actually, yeah, that should be JQ, and here I can say this.JQ equals JQ. Or you could call this dollar if you will. And then it says this function is not there, so create this function. Not there. So this is going to be commence.prototype.toHTML, which takes the option, does whatever it needs to do. Right now, it's basically going to simply call the commence guy with the options and going to pass this.jq. Will this work? Sure enough. So we just started pulling out some abstraction that then we can work with that abstraction, right? And this is, in my opinion, going to be remain pretty much like this for the rest of the entire building the, whatever your entire plugin, the jQuery portion is going to remain as is, right? And we are essentially passing in the jQuery, the handle to jQuery from here, which could be swapped with anything else. jQuery, whatever else you want to use, so you could swap it out, and then rest of your logic that is out here should continue to work without being bothered about jQuery specific stuff itself. I mean, there's obviously some dependencies. If there's some other library that you use does not have this kind of a functionality, maybe you'll run into some challenges, but otherwise this should be fine. In fact, now that I'm looking at it, do I even need this method anymore? Probably not, right? So I could simply inline this function and it should work fine. Inlining would not work, so we'll have to do this inlining manually, but it's not a big deal. The only difference is here we are saying it's dollar while here it's JQ. Just gonna rename this quickly to JQ. And then, actually it's this.jq. I should be able to plonk this in, get rid of this stuff. And it's complaining that inside the for each you can't find this, because this will be different. So let's just hold self, which is a pretty common pattern people use in the jQuery world or in general in JavaScript. Okay, so that inlining worked, no big deal. Can we start giving this a little bit more structure than what it is right now, right? One thing is we are dealing with this elements, which is basically, what is this? This is some kind of a comment thing, right? Which has user messages, possibly other kinds of things. That's one abstraction that we could pull out. and maybe this portion then would move to its own place, its own function. Right? This is basically building, taking a comment and displaying that, right? Which we ideally want to do in its own place. So we could do any number. This is dealing with when no comments are present, so some kind of a null comments kind of a feature. So let's do one thing at a time. Here, what can we do? Basically, we want to convert this into a comment, right? So I'm going to say new comment and pass the element to it. So let's call that as a comment. And then all of this stuff could be moved into that. And then we could simply say dot to, same, right? To underscore HTML function on it. Like we had a to HTML function on the comments, we have a to HTML function on the comment itself. So we need a comment similar to this. And what does the comment take? It doesn't take a dollar. It takes an element, which is nothing but a JSON object, right, at this point. So here, then we can start giving some meaning to this. So we are saying this is basically, we have a message. And then what else do we have? We have a user. Yeah. And the function that was missing. Interestingly, it doesn't let me create that. Okay, no big deal. Comment dot prototype dot to underscore HTML. What was this taking? Nothing. And then this is supposed to build out. Oh, this guy also would need the JQ. Right, so when we build the comments, we will also need to pass self.jq. So there is another thing that we're going to have here. Not elements.jq, sorry. So self.jq, all of this should work. The only other thing that won't work here is this. That's my comment, new comment to HTML. Undefined is not a function. Self is not there. Why do I still have self? Ooh. Of course, need to return the comment, right? Okay, so what we've just done is done a little bit of separation, a little bit more, kind of trying to flush out a little bit of the domain that we are working in. So we have the top level container, which is the comments container, and within that we have a comment container, a comment object. Why do all of this stuff? Why not just leave it in one method like we originally had? It was long, complex. Not really. I mean, this was not that long and complex. But remember, we talked about this being a design exercise, right? So do we want to flush out what our domain looks like? Or do we want to leave it all convoluted into one big method? One of the big things to me about functional programming is the whole notion of basically expressive code, right? Something that is very easy for anyone to read and understand. Expressiveness is very important. And then the whole aspect of composition, being able to compose things very quickly. Now, to me, this is kind of taking us towards that direction. Another thing that we could do here, which is basically, let's leave this for now, actually. Let's work on the next feature, and then it'll become a little bit more apparent. So the next feature, if we go back, some of the features that we were kind of talking about, which actually we didn't talk about it. Should be able to accept a comment, JSON or URL and fetch it from a server. The other thing was to display the most recent comment on the top. This is a little bit more interesting, which gets us more in the transformation kind of a mindset, right? Where you have a list of something, you want to transform it to something else and display that, right? Now, when we start working on this, it'll become a little bit more apparent of why we had to make some of these changes. So let's take this. And we are saying should display most recent comment on top. How do we know it's the most recent comment? You'll need some kind of a timestamp coming in with the comment, right? So let's call it something like last posted or last updated. And let's say the server is going to send us some kind of a timestamp like this. Same thing we obviously need to put here, but we're going to make this more recent than the other one. So if this is 20, let's make this 21, which means that our expectation now is kind of reverse, right? So this should become last. This should become first. Would you agree? We're reversing the direction. The other thing we also still need to do is just make sure the other places we update. So this remains 18 and 19. And last place to update. So with this, all the other tests should continue passing, except the last one should fail. Let's make sure that works. Yeah, should display most recent comment. So it's showing that it's actually giving us the other way around. So who wants to help me implement this? We want some kind of a sort, right? Sort based on the date, the last updated time. So here we are basically saying for each, and we are looping over here, right? While we are doing this for each, we ideally want to do what? To sort and then do a for each, right? Now this is, let's see if we can do this. So I have a list, I'm going to say map. It's going to take a function, right? This is going to get an element. What do I do with that element? Turn it into a comment like this. And then what do? I can say sort, yeah? So that should give me the comment in a sorted order. This might not work because we still need to implement the function, which takes in C1 and C2, and then were basically sort based on those two. Should we actually implement the sort function here, or should we push it to the comment itself? That's a good question. Let's first implement it here, and then we will figure out where it actually belongs. I would say, actually we've not stored in it. So last updated minus C2. I'm actually not sure what order it will be, but again, we have the test to help us figure that out. So this is going to map this, sort this, and then give us back our comments, right? And then I can take this comments and for each do this. Is this going to work? It's complaining that it doesn't have for each, so first let's make sure we add that. Updated, last updated. So that, just make sure here we've passed it as last updated, okay. So we've got the last updated, we've sorted it based on some order. We need to figure out if this is the right order. But also this is a string, so we can't really do something on the string itself. So I think we'll need to parse this into a date. So date dot parse is gonna convert this. And then I think we could do a subtraction directly. That should work. Will this work? For each doesn't need a comment, you're right. We already got a comment. The element itself is a comment. Good point. I want to get rid of this for each as well. Chain it before the, after the sort. And then that would not return anything. But this still doesn't get rid of the for each, but let's get this to work first before we jump off too much. So both these tests failed now. Why did both these tests fail? Should it be C2 minus C1? Yeah, that the order needs to be flipped. Is everyone with me so far? So now the next question is, can we actually push this functionality into the comment itself? So can I say C1 dot greater than C2? Doesn't know what C1 is. Comment dot prototype dot, let's call this other. So this would be other dot this. And so we're saying return C1 greater than C2. method name, this should work. The method name is what I guess you're saying. What's the right method name for that? What's the right function? So this is actually less than. Or we flip it around. Oh, actually, before. We're basically asking, is C1 before C2? Right? That's a good name. That should work. Hello. Okay. So let's quickly pause here. Like, what have we got so far? I would even say that this method of all of these conversions is probably not in the right place, in my opinion. Where should this whole map, all of that stuff go? Should it not be in the constructor? When you're constructing this from the lists, that's when probably you want to convert it to whatever type and store a sorted map. So then you can simply just display that. So I would say that this portion right here actually doesn't belong in this particular place. Ideally, this should have been something like this dot commence dot for each, something like that. And then in the constructor of commence, we want to say, actually, we don't pass the commence here, we only pass particular thing. So we will need the comments here, but then we could simply make this comments, this dot comments equals this was options dot comments. This will start complaining. We don't have, ideally to this guy, we are not passing any comments. So here you wouldn't have comments. So how do we deal with this? Sorry? This will become this of comments. If that's equal to 0, then just return that. The self, all of this business that we were doing, do we really need that now? Probably not. Just making sure we've done all the changes. So to HTML doesn't take anything in both the cases, to HTML, and the comments takes the dollar and the comments, or ideally it should just take the options, whatever options you might have. And here you're ideally getting the options and then say options.comments. Options.comments.map, construct a comment array, sort that, and store that in comments. And then whenever toHTML is called, you simply iterate over it, and if the length is 0, return nothing, else append that and return the HTML. Something I missed. This.jq. Undefined is not a function, evaluating this.jq in line number 9. What's line number 9? So we are in comment. Comment should have this.jq. What am I missing? What am I missing? Let's go back here. We've built the comments correctly. I could simply say dollar. That's the problem. Yep. What do you think of this last refactoring that we just did? Is this giving it a little bit of a functional feel to it? But it's still object-oriented in some sense. Right? So we're doing kind of a hybrid here. But notice all these objects that we have here, right? Are they doing anything that's, you know, having side effects? To HTML, again, to HTML is just building something in memory and returning. It doesn't really have a side effect in that sense, right? I mean, it's not yet manipulating the DOM, it's not updating the DOM, it's not producing any side effect. It's everything, whatever it's doing, is doing in memory and just returning something. I mean, returning the string could be, you know, something that we would say is, you know, a side effect in some sense. Hang on, what did I just do? I said inline this, why is it saying two local variables? Sorry, this should just be, so what I was saying is that this is not really having a side effect in the sense that it's not mutating anything that you're passing or updating the DOM or any of that stuff. This is pretty much working on its own, right? And then the last step, this is where we are actually having a side effect. This line is the only line where we are actually having a side effect. On the DOM itself, we are manipulating the DOM itself. But everything above this, if you look at it, is essentially side effect free. And technically these, I would call most of these functions and pure functions. Yeah? So what I'm trying to get here is that basically these tests kind of started driving me in a certain direction. So, you know, the testing of this becomes easier. Ideally, if you were really a TDD purist, what you would do now is you would pick up your comments and you would start writing tests around that. And you start building more and more logic in it by just using the comments and not even being worried about the jQuery itself, right? Having to go through the plugin or any of that stuff. And this would all just be in memory. You send something, it gives you back a string, you keep asserting that. So none of this would require any side effects, and the tests really kind of start pushing you in the direction where you can keep getting, you know, pushing yourself towards a pure function. Let's do a quick time check. We have another 35 minutes left. So far, is everyone with me? Any quick questions at this point before we move on? Is TDD helping here? How has it helped us so far? Let's do a quick recap. So it helped with refactoring. So remember one of the points we started, when we started, I was talking about, like, it is about, you know, design. And why is it about design is because now I have the safety net where I have the courage to constantly keep refactoring. And I could pull out the abstraction, I could pull out things, I could do things. And we said, okay, sort does not belong here, let's move it out. This does not belong here, let's move it out. Those are the kind of things that actually is what TDD helping you do, right? That safety net and the confidence it gives you. So that's the important part in my opinion, right? And because of that, I would say then you start applying your functional concepts on top of it, and it starts pushing you in that direction. Yeah? Any other observation? Any other things that you think this is helping or hindering? I don't see how this is applicable in real life. Okay. So, like, there are a couple of questions in there, so let's break it down. One is, if you have external factors which are outside your control, right, whether internet is available or not, or some other kinds of parameters, right, and you have some logic written around that, how do you design such that, you know, you can safeguard yourself in some sense against all these variables and still be quite confident that your logic itself seems to work fine, right? To me, that's the first step. Overall app itself, we are not really talking at that level here in terms of the overall app, but let's say I can safeguard myself, and within those boundaries, can I at least make sure my stuff works correctly? To me, that's the first step. And there again, whatever external dependencies you have, let it be internet, let it be, you know, availability of, let's say, GPS is on or not, other kinds of parameters, right? How would you deal with that? Like, I want to turn this into more of a discussion. Like, what would you do based on what you've seen so far? Is there a way you can abstract that into some kind of a system? What I guess what I'm kind of hinting towards is that, you know, you have these dependencies which are outside your control. Can you wrap them into some kind of object, some kind of a container, right? And pass that in to your logic. And then let your logic do what it needs to do depending on the values it's going to get from this guy. So when I'm actually building this, when I'm trying to design this, I can simulate all these different values and see how my logic itself works. It also helps me design in a better way, because I don't want in random different places inside my code suddenly going and calling off some system libraries or some other libraries, right? I want generally one layer where I'm doing those kind of things, because that could change tomorrow. iOS new version could come in, or Android new version could come in, and they might change some of those APIs and things like that. Do you want to then go hunt around in all the places and go change it, or rather have an adapter is the right name for it, an adapter where you would make those changes, right? So to me, that's the first step. And again, test-driven development would push you in that direction, because otherwise it would be extremely hard to test. Because it's extremely hard to test, you will be forced to write some kind of an adapter on things that you depend on, and then pass those in. And that, you know, in general is referred to as the dependency inversion principle, right? Where instead of from within your code, you deciding where you're going to get something, it's given to you from outside, and then let your code work inside that. So it kind of pushes you in that direction of dependency inversion, which is again a good thing from decoupling point of view. So tomorrow you could take the same logic and run it on a different version, and the only place probably you need to change is the adapter. So maybe that kind of gives you a certain direction in terms of how this would help, where you have a lot of other parameters that are also changing. But, you know, that's the general direction I would take. The overall app itself, whether it works or not, there are a lot of other criteria, like the look and feel, whether it's actually being displayed correctly or not. Those kind of things is a separate thing. And again, there are different kinds of testing that would focus on that level of assurance, right? But to me, the key is, if my logic itself is not working, there's no way the app as a whole will work together. So let's make sure these nuts and bolts of your application are actually plugged in and working correctly. All right, that's a good question. Any other questions so far? What does that mean? What's the difference between TDD and BDD? Old wine, new bottle kind of a thing to some extent. Depends on who you ask. If you ask Dan North, who coined that term. So Dan and I used to work together, who coined the term BDD. His whole thing is the word tests in TDD is misleading. Okay? So let's call it behavior-driven development, because what we are really trying to flush out is the behavior of the system. And it is not only just a programmer thing. Let's involve, if you're working in a bank, for example, let's involve the business analyst to understand how trades work. because as programmers we don't understand the nitty-gritties of those, right? So let's build some kind of a non-technical platform where people can collaborate and then use that as a way to flesh out the behavior of the system, right? While TDD, again, there are different levels at which you can apply TDD. You can apply at the unit level, kind of what we are trying to do. You can also step back and apply it at a much bigger level. Actually, what we did is not really at a unit level because we are actually testing the whole plugin in some sense, right? But now we could take each of our comment and each of our comments object, and then we could test drive that. That would be more of a unit level thing, right? So like this, you can see that you can actually apply TDD at a much higher level as well. And there's a difference between outside in TDD and an inside out TDD. So if we started with a comment object and we started test driving it and slowly flushed out the comments object and then something else and then something else, that would be an inside out way of doing test driven development, right? While what we did here is an outside in, which is kind of similar to what you would do in a behavior driven development. So if you really talk, there's not much difference in terms of it's more of a naming thing and reducing confusion, but honestly, it's created more confusion. Now people are all confused. What is the difference between TDD, BDD, all of that stuff? So I would actually, to be purist, I would say BDD is a style of TDD. Okay. So as the DOM structure gets complicated, right? Again, if you look at where the whole thing is moving, you know, let it be React or any of these guys, what they're trying to do is componentize it, right? So you would essentially componentize each of those things and work in components. In fact, this is kind of taking you in that direction. Now I could go one step further and talk about virtual DOM, right? Which is like the big new thing that everyone seems to be talking. Like, how easy would it be for us to apply a virtual DOM on this? Right? Really what we need to do is do a diff between what changes we've made on the DOM so far, and then look at the real DOM and apply only the diffs. That's oversimplifying what a virtual DOM is, but that's the core idea behind it. Right? You're working throughout in the in-memory DOM, which is what we are doing, and then look at the diff with the actual DOM and apply that diff. Right? So to your question, if your DOM structure starts getting more complicated, componentize it and each component can be tested. Right? And then you will need a higher level test which will make sure these components on the DOM itself works correctly. But then you wouldn't need 50,000 of those tests, right? Because each of those components itself is well flushed out. So I think that should work. If you look at a lot of React kind of stuff, it's kind of going in that direction a little bit. Any other questions? Shall we move on? Do you want to look at the Ajax one? We have another 15 minutes or so. Actually, what I can do is I can quickly jump and show you, instead of doing the whole thing, I'll show you a ready example that you can look at. It's how do you isolate yourself from Ajax requests and things like that. Okay. Let's quickly jump here. There were other things about whether private comments should be visible to other people or not and things like that. So that again is implemented by having a JSON structure and marking something as a private on it and then making sure that's not visible to you. But I'm more interested in the Ajax one. So let's get to that quickly. Okay, here's one. So should fetch data from a URL and display the comments. So what we are saying here is expect this Ajax response, which is going to give you this three comments. Then you're saying jasmine.ajax.stub requests to a particular URL. So if a URL, you know, if your app requests for this URL, simply return 200 whatever HTTP status, the content type and the JSON string. This is literally all you need to do to stub out a AJAX call from within your application. And then here we are passing, so earlier we were passing comments. If you don't pass comments and you pass in a URL, then ideally you want to go fetch from a URL and get this, right? So we pass a URL and then we would expect that, you know, whatever, Jack should be first, James should be last, and the size should be whatever your length was that you passed in, that length. So how does the code actually look for this? So I have new view, and then I'm saying apply comments. Here we're doing a little bit of a passing a callback kind of implementation. And this is simply saying that apply these comments with these options, and here's a callback that, you know, will actually do the append or whatever. So in the apply comments, we are saying if option.url, then fetch the comments, else simply get the HTML from the comments and then call the callback. Another common question people ask is, how do you test callbacks and stuff like that? You know, can that be done with TDD? Can TDD drive that kind of a design and stuff like that? So again, this is an example where we essentially ended up with a callback kind of a mechanism, and that's kind of tested fully. So fetch is basically just doing our standard whatever JSON, get JSON from the server. And that's, whenever it actually does this get JSON, it'll end up getting stubbed out because of the setting we have here. Jasmine will intercept that call and then just reset that. That's it. That is as simple as how to do stubbing out of your AJAX request. So this is again another example where, you know, you have an external dependency and you've stubbed out the external dependency, and you're basically, you know, making sure for different values this works correctly. In fact, there are a bunch of few different tests. So here, when you're trying to fetch and you get an error message, how does your code respond to that? Does that handle it? One of the big things about this is the negative path testing becomes so much more easier with this kind of this level of you know, behavior specification, rather than doing it at the end-to-end level. So here we are saying it will give a 400 status. Then what do we expect? We expect a div with error and say failed fetching comments from URL. So I'm pretty much done. I think this covers most of the stuff. I went a bit too fast because of the last time's experience. I ran short of time, so this time I went faster. So any other questions? Otherwise, this is pretty much what I had. Yeah. It depends what level your requirements are changing, or what your design, what level your design is changing, right? So again, what I would recommend for this particular thing is don't write all your spec at the jQuery plugin level, right? You would write your tests at lower levels, which is your comments, your comment, those levels. And what might change is, let's say, one of those things, not the entire thing. Maybe something in the comment might change. Then only that needs to be tested, and the tests for that needs to be updated. The rest of the stuff should work as normal, right? So what I have found is that this actually helps you deal with changes in design and requirements much more efficiently than the other way around, because there you assume you know everything and you design something, and then even a small thing changes, then there might be a lot of repercussion. Here also, because of the way we have built this, right, incrementally, we took one thing at a time. We didn't have the last updated time when we started. Let's say that was a new requirement that came in. That was, in my opinion, relatively easy to implement because the design was fairly decoupled. So that to me is an advantage. So when you have design changes, when you have requirement changes, this will actually be much easier to deal with because of the decoupling that you've achieved. So yes, some tests might need to be changed, a few places, but not everything. But the more important thing is when you change, the confidence that you have that actually I didn't break anything is much more important. Otherwise, you end up spending a lot of time manually checking that as a developer. Right? So it'll at least save that time that you're going to be spending. Okay? Any other questions? If not, the lunch is waiting. All right. Thank you then. Stubbing about the Ajax request, yeah? What do you want to know? This is basically it. jasmine.ajax.stub request, give the URL and say what do you expect in return. What is the JSON that you expect in return? So because this is running within Karma, right? Karma will basically stub out that call the moment it sees that call and then just plug this in. So that's what Karma, the framework itself, is doing. It's not technically Karma itself. There is a little framework called Jasmine Ajax. That's essentially what is doing that. So it's the Jasmine Ajax plugin in Karma, which actually blocks out the call and returns that. All right, thank you guys.